They are worried that all these Hanumans are strong, but we have no chance to serve Ram. We should make a click that we should divide all these armies of Ram, and we will do. Four. Lakshman, Bharata, Shatrughna and Sita. And they divided all kinds of services of Ram. And they left no service for Hanuman. And doing whole day. He was seeing the occasion that I should go and serve. But before this, the four were ready to do. Always doing. He was so worried, Hanuman. He told that, I will die if I am not serving Ram. So give me something. That was, we have left no service. We have divided everything. We will do everything. You have done up till now so many services. Now you will serve. Then he told that, give me that. I should do like this. If any texts yawn, then in India they do like this. Ram, 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 Ram. No? We should not take this. This is the symptom of alasya, idleness, and if it laziness. So if it comes, we should do like Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Radhe, 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 Shiva, Shiva, Shiva. No. So he told that, please give me this service. When Ram will take high yawn, then I will do this. Achai, you should do. And he sat on the door and he was doing always like this. And Ram was taking yawn always. Today we anyone could not serve because Ram always doing this. He had no time to take prasadam, no time of sleepness, no time of anything, no messaging, nothing, always doing. And new big problem came. Four are dressed up, Sita, and they have no time to serve because he was doing always. And they told that, why you are doing so? Because you have not given any service, I don't know when he will take yawn. So I am doing always this. And Ram was always doing this. Then they came to Hanuman and told that, excuse me, what do you want? We will give service to you. And then they divided also to service. So Hanuman cannot be without. He is Prime Minister of Ram. He is helper of Ram. He is servant of Ram. He is chamar, paduka, and fan, everything. His tail is like chamar. Sometimes making a fort to from his. Once, when a battle was going between Ram and Raman, skillfully Raman called his son, that is Mahiraman. He used to live in England. And from here he called and he went there. Ram told that, my dear son, you should kill both Ram and Lakshman. Oh, I can do easily. And he took the shape of Vibhishan. And in the night he entered where Ram and Lakshman were sleeping. With cord, bed, he took both and entered in Patal Lok and came to this. Here. He has a Kali, Mahakali. And he was worshipper of Mahakali. He brought it And in the night, he was preparing to give sacrifice of Ram and Lakshman head to Devi. So many demons were there. And everything preparation was done. My Raman told that, what you want? You want to take anything?
Any desire?
Ram Lakshman told that, no desire. Then a very big fire was burning there. And they were ready to take the head of Ram and Lakshman to kill and to give it in sacrifice. Anyhow, Hanuman knew this. All were crying in there in Lanka. And Hanuman at once jumped from there and came to this England, this place. And in a very little shape, in monkey, but more
like a worm.
Like very little, like a more than ant. And he entered in a flower and he went to Devi. When priest gave this, or Mahiraman gave this mala to Devi, he became very weak and kept his feet on the head of Kali. And he pressed Kali so much that she went in patal. And he took the swords and he cut down all with my Ram and gave in
fire.
Then Ram and Krishna, Ram and Lakshman were so happy. He told that we should now go to Lanka. Now how we can go? Oh, come on my soldier. So Ram and Lakshman sat on the soldier of Hanuman, and Hanuman quickly. But there one thing happened. There was a monkey who told Hanuman that, why you have come here? Who are you? Who are you? Hanuman told, oh, I am son of Hanuman. Oh, I have no son, I am Hanuman. I have no son. Oh, I am your son. How? Because when you jumped in sea after burning Lanka, your sweat came into sea and a fish took it. And from that fish, I am your son. So I am saving, protecting this kingdom of Mahiram. You cannot enter. Then Hanuman forcibly defeated him and he binded in his own tail there. And he defeated and he killed Mahiraman and killed. So Hanuman can do everything. He was general also, private secretary also, always serving. Once Sita Devi was in Ayodhya and he went in his decorated room, Shringar Bhavan. What? Shringar Bhavan? And after taking bath, she was taking sindoor here for Indian chest ladies, it is essential. It is called Sohar. Widow don't take. But if they are married, they should take this shine. So Sita was doing so. Hanuman at once went there and told the mother, what you are doing? What is this red thing? He told that, oh son, dear son, this is called Suhaag. A chaste lady should take it so that his husband should be so long life. So for my husband long life, I am taking this. Then Sita After decorated herself, he came to Ram in the council. And Hanuman went in the, that room,
dressing room.
And he took all the sindoor, a red collar, and gave water and to everywhere. If Sita takes here only and Ram has a long life, then I will color myself a hole that Ram should live long and long. And he went, he also went in the council. All were laughing. Ram was also laughing. Oh, Hanuman, what we have done today? I have done it only to longly you, for you. If Sita takes only very lean and thin here, and your life is so prolonged, then I do that in my whole body that you should live long, long and longer. So Hanuman is suffering in so many ways. Without Ram, he cannot live. Even Krishna is calling him, he is not ready to go. But if anyone tells that he is not Krishna, he is Ram, calling in Ayodhya, at once he quickly comes more than Garuda, he is so much superior than Garuda. And he comes at once. He sees that Krishna has become Ram. And he told that, oh Rukmini, Satyabhama, you should become Sita. But he denied, I cannot be Sita. Then he told to Rukmini. Rukmini had once taken Sita. And he took Darshan off and again later. So Hanuman, always serving, whether Ram is there or not, anywhere Kirtan is going off Ram, he is there. He is hearing by lakhs and lakhs ears. He is chanting lakhs and lakhs mouths and lakhs ears. So we should serve our devotee Krishna like this. So in evening I will finish this. Gaur Prema.
Kempurush.
He also. Like Vrindavan, Krishna lives always in Vrindavan. Never lives. So he lives in Kempurush. But you cannot see. As we cannot see Krishna in Vrindavan and cannot see Mahaprabhu in Nodi, but still he is playing and doing everything. So Hanuman is in Kempurush Vash. What is Kempurush Vash? You know? Tibbat. Tibbat, you know? Tibbat is Kempurush Vash. But we cannot see with these eyes. Gaur Prema. If you chant more, I will leave. Jai Jai Radha Raman Hari Bol. Jai Jai Radha Raman Hari Bol.
Thank you. Oh, Assembly of God. All glory to the Assembly of God. All glory to the Assembly of God. All glory to Shri Shri Guru Shri Granda.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
harmonium. Where is your harmonium? You can, you remember this Gurvashtak hole? You have to do it in this tone. Samsaradava nalani dhaloka tanayakarunna ghana ghana Pratashakanyana gunanavasya vande guroshi charanarvin. Can you do in this tone? No? Like Damodarashtakam? Listen to you. So you can do. You cannot do? Yes. Sansara dava nalani dhaloka pranayaka runna dhana dhana praptasya kalya gunarna Vande Guroshi Charanaravindam Vande Guroshi Charanaravindam Vande Guroshi Charanaravindam Vande Guroshi Mahaprabhu ki kaun
tanaviya ki
Vande Guroshi Charanaravindam. Thank you.
Today is auspicious day of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Bhakti Vinod Thakur Dishyakaran's day. And also the Dishyakaran's day of Srila Gadadhar Pandit. I want that we should glorify them and we should try to adopt his teachings and his everything characteristics of bhajan, because in this yuga he is like Bhagiratha, who brought the Ganges River in India. So Srila Bhakti didn't write like that. The Bhakti current was dried, but Bhakti Ben Thakur again brought it in India and pushed over the whole world. So we'll tell first with this energy. You can tell something. Ashwar Prabhu, yes. First you should begin.
About
because you are senior.
About Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur?
Yes.
Well, Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur.
Give me mic.
It's going to be very exciting to speak in public. Om Gyan Narangasya Yanam Yanasya Bhakti Chakshura Miritam Yanam Kasmai Shri Guru. I offer pranam to my teacher Guru, Shri Bhakti Vedanta Swami, Prabhupada, to my Shiksha Guru, Shri Bhakti Rakshak, Shri Radhya Goswami, to my Shiksha Guru, Shri Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Maharaj. Yes, Shri Bhakti Vinod Thakur would not have arisen, we would not be sitting here all together. It is solely due to the sun of bhakti rising in his heart that the rays of this sun are extending into this part of the world which actually has always been very, very dark. India has always been blessed by the devotion of many saints, but here in the West, such luminous personalities have never appeared. Some mystics, which may be compared to Indian impersonal mystics that have been here, but such a personality as Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur has always been unknown in this part of the world. The first ray of the sun of his mercy to appear, to extend into the west, were some senior sannyas disciples of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, his son and disciple, and they preached here and were successful to some extent. For instance, due to their preaching, thanks to their preaching, one Austrian professor named Walter Eitlitz, he became a devotee of, he became a disciple of, or a grand disciple of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and he preached in the form of writing. He wrote a complete biography of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in German language, and was published by the Swedish Academy. He also wrote an autobiography, which is called Bhakta, about how he became a Bhakta. He used to be a poet, an Austrian poet. He was the first to extensively glorify the mission started by Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur. And also, most of the devotees here may not know, he was awarded together with a famous peace activist named Julius Weizsäcker, who was a brother of the president of Germany, the Erasmus Prize, which is very prestigious. And this person wanted to share this prize with Walter Eidlitz, the great devotee, because he found his writings so very important for the Western world. Unfortunately, they were little read. They were little read. They were beautiful books, but no one was reading them. So it was extreme good fortune that a score years later, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada came, and he preached very extensively. He came in the right time, and he found many receptive ears, and hundreds and thousands of Western hearts melted when they heard his preaching and surrendered to him, and the chanting of the holy names began to spread all over the world. After Srila Prabhupada left this world, as we so often see when such a great acharya leaves his body, uncertainty arose, devotees did not know so very well how to proceed further. Some of them, who adhered very cautiously to Srila Prabhupada's instructions, knew that in India, I'm speaking from a Western perspective, but within in India, there were especially two personalities that he wanted his disciples to take guidance from if they didn't know how to proceed. And one of them was Srila Bhaktivedanta Srila Deva Goswami Maharaj, who helped them also very much inspired by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. These great personalities were completely under the divine inspirational influence of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Srila Maharaj also glorified Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur in a very beautiful poem about that, in a country called it here. Srila Maharaj wrote beautiful poetry in Sanskrit, as we rarely see being done nowadays, in beautiful meters, mellifluous, enchanting. And so he also glorified Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And Srila Maharaj also left his body, which was very difficult to swallow for us all. And within Srila Prabhupada's movement, there was also a great acharya, and Srila Govinda Maharaj came. But he also left his body. All these great souls left their bodies, and now amongst us, Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayana Maharaj has come as, in our present view, the ultimate possibility of hope that has been granted to us by Srila Bhaktivedanta Thakur. Yeah, so far, I would like to.
Chandrani should speak something. Give the mic. Can you stand up? Or you can come and sit here. There. And from sitting there, you can.
In 1967, our Srila Prabhupada sent me to Montreal, Canada, in North America, to serve in the opening of the ISKCON temple there, which was the third of the temples that he established in the Western world. So the temple president, Janardhan Prabhu, had heard that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur had sent his book, which he wrote in the late 1800s, his book, Lord Chaitanya's Life and Precepts, that he had sent them to McGill University, which was near to the temple. So Janardhan Prabhu and I went there to the library at McGill University, and after many hours of searching through all the shelves, we actually found the book, and then somehow got it to Srila Prabhupada, who was in New York. And then Prabhupada later put that book as his introduction to his summary of the Chaitanya Charitamrita called Teachings of Lord Chaitanya. Then he had me do a painting from the photograph that Janardhan Prabhu had also sent him of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur sitting or standing next to a row of scriptures. And generally Prabhupada had me write something on the painting because he always liked to spread knowledge in any way. So I would not only do the painting, but I had to write with the paintbrush at the corner something according to what the painting was. So for this painting of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he had me write that in 1896, which is the year of the birth of A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who is the pioneer of Krishna consciousness in the West, sent this book, Lord Chaitanya's Life and Precepts, to McGill University in the West. And also, then when Prabhupada was going to India for the first time since his coming to America in July of 1967, he was leaving from New York, just before he left for the airport, and then of course we found out 30 years later that there was one person to meet him at the other side in Delhi, and that was Srila Narayan Maharaj. And there Prabhupada had Srila Narayan Maharaj train up his first Western preachers in preaching in India, and where Narayan Maharaj also gave sannyas to Kirtan Nanda Maharaj and helped Srila Prabhupada in so many other ways. So just before Prabhupada left for the airport, he came to the end of the temple room and looked up at the wall and at the paintings of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, large paintings about 24 by 32 inches. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur and Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur. And he offered his full dandavats to the pictures. And then when he stood up again, he said, "The grandfather and the great-grandfather take care of the children better than the father." So Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur and Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur will take care of you better than I, because they're present here. And there's one very nice story about Bhaktivinoda Thakur that Prabhupada told, and Srila Narayan Maharaj also tells, about how one of the main things, as Srila Gurudev just mentioned, was that there were so many sahajiisms and so many anti-bhakti philosophies, and the so-called followers of Mahaprabhu were engaged in debauchery activities in the name of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur came to give the light of bhakti and defeat all non-bhakti philosophies. So in one episode, he had heard, because he was a government minister, a government magistrate in Jagannath Puri, and he had heard that there was one false incarnation of Vishnu named Visikasena, who said that he was an incarnation of Mahavishnu, and he wanted to have rasa dance with so many ladies. So he would ask so many households to give their daughter, and in fear and ignorance they gave their daughter, and he was engaged in debauch activities. So the government requested Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur to go and do something to save the situation. So he went there to see this false yogi, and the man said, "I'm an incarnation of Vishnu." So Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, "Wonderful, then why don't you go and see Lord Jagannath, because he's also God." So the false yogi said, "Jagannath, he's made of wood. I am the real Vishnu." So at that point, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur arrested him, and After he arrested him, his whole family became sick because this yogi had powers, mystic powers, from his non-spiritual practices. He got some supernatural powers. So his wife said to him, "No, maybe he is some incarnation or something, and that's why we're all getting sick. Maybe if you don't release him, then we'll all die." So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, "Then let us all die, but this rascal should be punished." So in the courtroom, he was sentenced to a year and a half in prison. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur ordered the members